You're watching the Reb Zone Sports Show on Fox 5.
Tonight we go out with everything we got.
Old rivals meet again. Straight ahead of the Reb Zone, we recap a chilly night in Provo that saw the Rebels do a lot of things right, but questions still remain. Plus, sitting down with wide receiver Devontae Davis. Find out why number 81 has made his mark with his team both on and off the field. And we recap the Run and Rebel opener with reaction from Coach Dave Rice and the players. It's not time to fly south for the winter, but it is time to defrost in the Reb Zone right now.
This is the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by Born and Raised, the official home of the Rebels on the Road, and by Cox Communications.
Good evening. Welcome inside the Reb Zone. Thanks for dropping by. Kevin Bollier alongside UNLV head football coach Bobby Hauck. And yesterday's game at BYU, kind of basically the epitome of the season, yeah, right there, but just can't get over the hump.
Yeah, you know, if you can, or if I can take away the fact that the wrong team won, it was a really fun game to be a part of. You know, both teams were physical. It was tough, the cold weather, natural grass. Our guys went out and fought their tails off, actually played pretty well most of the game. It was just a lot of back and forth. It was a heck of a football game, and you know, we just weren't good enough to get them.
Well, lots to talk about with this one. Let's start taking a closer look. The Rebels stayed right with BYU until late.
We go out, we leave it all on the field right now. Hey, they're going to come out and talk in the mouth.
A bitter cold night in Provo, but the Rebel offense slowly heated up. On UNLV's second possession, quarterback Blake Decker hits Devontae Davis for a first down at the BYU 30. That led to Jonathan Leyva's 46-yard field goal, and the Rebels struck first for a 3-0 lead. BYU answered quickly. Christian Stewart with the lateral to Jordan Leslie. He goes 30 yards for the touchdown to make it 7-3. The Rebel defense dug in and they made some big stops, but the Cougars were able to get into the end zone again on this 8-yard run by Paul Lasicki. It was 14-3 BYU with 6:18 left in the second quarter. Then the play of the night for the Rebels, Shaq Murray-Lawrence gets loose outside, cuts back inside, crisscrosses the field, and he has blockers out in front of him. 68 yards for the touchdown, and UNLV cut it to 14-10. On the kickoff, the Pooch and the Rebels recover in business at the BYU 38. Decker gets it to Whiteley, who takes it down to the 5-yard line for first and goal. UNLV had to settle for another Leyva field goal, though, and they were only down one at 14-13. Just before the half, BYU drove down the field and scored on the 7-yard touchdown run. BYU knew they were in a dogfight, though, as both teams went into the locker room with the Cougars up 21-13. BYU had the ball to start the second half, and they marched right down the field. Stewart hit Devin Mahina, who dragged the Rebel defender into the end zone to make it 28-13. The Rebel offense was forced to punt, but the punt was botched by BYU, giving UNLV the ball in the red zone at the 18. On first down, Decker's pass is incomplete, and he is leveled. Staying down on the field, Decker would not return. Enter Jared Leibowitz for the second week in a row. UNLV would have to settle for a field goal. They did cut the lead to 12 at 28-16. The Cougars scored again as Stewart hit Lasicki. UNLV tried to get back in it as Leibowitz gets his first career touchdown pass, this to Devontae Boyd, who goes 40 yards for the score, the flap, and the flag. It was a 19-point lead for BYU. Both teams traded possessions in the fourth quarter. BYU comes away with the 42-23 win.
All right, we want to start with the Decker injury for the second week in a row. What do we know, and how bad is it? Is he going to be available?
Hopefully it'll be available. You know, you never know. He got roughed up on the one play. He actually didn't take too many shots yesterday, but the one play he couldn't. This play we're looking at, he couldn't come back from. You know, he's just got to hang in there and we kind of had it picked up. Just step up there rather than running out and getting drilled like that. But you know, I think he'll be all right, and hopefully he'll be able to play next Saturday.
His performance at that point was actually pretty sharp because this was a game he wanted. He was cut from BYU. That story's been well documented. Other than a couple of drop passes that he had, he actually seemed on the ball in the first half.
Yeah, I thought Blake was on point. I thought his checks were good. I thought his accuracy was pretty good. He pulled it down, ran it, and moved the chains a couple of times. So he was operating pretty well. You know, I think we were playing pretty well around him at the time. You know, it was a heck of a ball game. You know, when we lost him, it put us behind the eight ball a little bit. We weren't able to move the ball as well as we had with him in the game, certainly.
Jared Leibowitz comes in for the second week in a row. Last week we talked about the fact that he needed more game snaps to maybe get his touch down, that he was picking the right receivers, he just wasn't getting the ball. After seeing what you saw yesterday in BYU, are you more encouraged at his progress?
Well, he did some good things. You know, he beat out Nick Sherry for the second spot, and he's done some good things. He's got pretty good understanding of what the offense is trying to get done. He hit a couple of passes, which he wasn't able to do a week ago in terms of the accuracy part. And then the big touchdown to Devontae Boyd was, you know, freshman to freshman. And, you know, there's some good things there.
Devontae Boyd breaks the UNLV reception mark in this game, but he also took a freshman mistake, unsportsmanlike penalty after a touchdown when they were down. Those are the things you get, I guess, with a great freshman is the good and also the stuff that you're going to have to be teachable moments.
Anytime you're playing guys, whether they're newcomers for some reason, whether they're freshmen or JC transfers, there's going to be some of that where they've got to learn. And this was a valuable teaching moment. We utilized it as such, and we'll move on from that. It was a heck of a good play, though.
It was a great pass and a great run. And speaking of run, Shaq Murray-Lawrence rattles off a big run. And for the first time this season, we've seen some breakaway speed on a long run with some blocking downfield, and they were able to finish the job on that play.
Yeah, he's the one of our backs that has the most top-end speed. We're getting another look at it. It was a great run. A lot of guys working their tails off to get some blocks downfield, and he broke through two profile tackles, or arm tackling, whatever you want to call it, and got it to the house, and obviously that was a big play in the game.
The defense actually did a really good job up front. We knew it was going to be physical in the trenches, and they got a lot of penetration in terms of getting to the quarterback, but they just could not get him wrapped up and let those plays extend.
Yeah, we had, in reviewing the film, we have the ability to go back and look at it. We tackled really well for the most part. Certainly their backs and receivers, we tackled well. We had five times we had the quarterback in our hands and for sacks and big losses and didn't get him down. And, I mean, that right there, that play is the first one of the game, and that's a conversion, and that drive went down and scored a touchdown. That happened three times, and, you know, that might be the difference between us winning and losing the game, just simply making those three plays.
The takeaway from this one is I think there's a fine line here, the expectations for this team coming in. You see the glimpses of why there were those expectations, but this is a team that just can't get the big stop or the big play when they need to have it, and then the game kind of gets away from them late.
Yeah, and you and I have talked about it a little bit. You know, our margin for error is not great. When we lose a player here, a player there, whether it's for injury or academic reasons or conduct or something like that, the young guys or the newcomers that we're bringing in aren't as good. And that's just the situation we're in. And we haven't been able to overcome some of those things. We're playing really hard. As you and I have talked, we're working hard, we're coaching hard, we're playing hard. And we just can't quite get over the top. We were in that game last night. It was a fun game to be a part of, but the wrong team won because they were better than us.
Well, it's time to start looking ahead to next week already. When we return, we're going to have a preview of the last road game of the season as UNLV prepares for Hawaii. We're also going to sit down with wide receiver Devontae Davis to find out how hard it was sitting out with that injury and why big things are still in store.
You're watching the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by Born and Raised, the official home of the Rebels on the Road, and by Cox Communications.
From the bitter cold of Provo to the warm nights of Honolulu, UNLV is island bound Saturday for a game against Hawaii.
It has been another long season for Hawaii. Just like last year, the Warriors have been in a lot of games, but haven't been able to close things out. A lot of that is due to an offense that has looked great in spurts, but overall hasn't produced as expected. Hawaii is in the bottom third of the country for production in the air and on the ground, and amongst the worst in points per game. They do run a balanced offense and like to mix things up. Defensively, Hawaii brought in Utah State's defensive coordinator to shore things up, and they have been able to limit some of the more potent offenses on the schedule, but they've given up some late touchdowns. Then there's the factor of playing on the island. Visiting teams, including UNLV, have always struggled on trips to Hawaii, and it's something that Hawaii plays into.
The coaches always complain they have to fly all that way. I said, yeah, but you do it once. We have to do it seven times coming the other way. So, but hopefully it'll take its toll. I told Bobby, take you guys out to the beach, let them have a lot of fun, and maybe we'll see what happens there.
It is also Hawaii's last home game of the season, senior night. So there will be some added fire to the luau.
Before we get to the X's and O's, let's talk about the
Norm's,
aloha.
Norm's got here. Some good advice for me. We tried that going to the beach stuff. It didn't work. We haven't played worth a darn over there, so we're changing what we do.
You're going in a little later than you normally. A lot of teams will go over on a Thursday for a Hawaii game to get acclimated to the time change and kind of let them do their thing, get it out of their system. You guys are deciding to go in on Friday.
Yeah, we tried the other way a couple of times, and it's probably the worst we've played in a four-year span. And so we obviously are changing that. We're going to fix it. Talk to, we discussed that with a lot of folks before we tried it that way, and then we've revisited it with some other folks that have had some success. We're going to try it a little different.
On the field, the Hawaii defense really is the key to what they've been doing this year. They shut out San Jose State 13-0 yesterday, and they seem to be playing at a pretty good level right now.
Yeah, really interesting. They shut San Jose out. I haven't had a chance to watch that game yet, but the red zone defense must have been great because San Jose was the first team since 1948 that didn't punt in a game and still got shut out. So taking the ball away, winning the red zone is a good thing to do when you're hanging your hat on something on defense.
They are a team that does a little balance with their offense, and they have that. Their running back has been tough and is just getting back. And he's always somebody who you know is going to run hard. They're going to have to get him to the ground because the play's never dead with him.
Yeah, Joey Iosefa is a big lad, first of all. He runs hard. He gets his pads down. He's a punishing runner. If you go back into the old people watching, or the Earl Campbell type back, I mean, he's going to chew you up a little bit. So you better tackle him low. And I saw him this summer at the league meetings where we saw Norm talking. And I said, Joey, we're going to tackle you low now. Be ready.
The Rebels have been hit hard by injuries this season. We know that. There's been none bigger than Devontae Davis, a wide receiver. Number 81, though, is back, which shows as much about Davis the man as it does about Davis the player.
Well, you can tell everybody. Yeah, you can tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man.
Devontae Davis has turned himself into an elite receiver and one of the all-time Rebel greats. The Houston native was a state triple jump champion and had big schools coming after him for track, but not for football, except UNLV, and he has remained loyal.
Ever since, I walked in the door, I kind of made sure I did everything in my power to not make them, regret taking a chance on me.
After a record-setting season last year, Davis hurt his wrist just before his return home to Houston. The middle of the schedule has seen him watching and coaching from the sidelines.
It was definitely tough watching the team, knowing that, you can be out there trying to help them and doing something, but it kind of taught me to be more vocal with the team and, kind of help guys on the sideline, telling them what I see, what they can do.
Davis returned against Air Force and picked up right where he left off, and any apprehension was gone.
Catching that first pass was kind of like, oh, I'm back in it. It's been a long time, but it's great that it's happening now.
Davis is an NFL prospect, and while many players after an injury in their senior season would just focus on the next step, He worked that much harder to get back and play for UNLV.
It's not about me. I play for something bigger than who I am, bigger than one person. It's about a team.
That kind of attitude and talent makes Davis who he is. Not just a great football player, but a great man. In December, he will be the first in his family to graduate college, and he did it in 3.5 years. It fulfills a promise he made to himself when he left Houston for Las Vegas. Make the most of all opportunities and just go for it.
I'm more than happy I came. Coming to Vegas ended up being the best decision I ever made.
Fan mail me, fan mail 3, 1, 2, 3, fan mail.
Always will.
You've been coaching football a long time. I've been covering football a long time. I think we both agree that this is just one of the best guys that you've been around.
Yeah, he's a special cat. I mean, he's a good player. He's an even better guy. Smart, tough, great teammate. But, you know, the things he said, it's why I just love this team. I hate our record. I detest it. I just love this team because they care about each other. They play hard. The family atmosphere in that locker room is unbelievable. And it's probably why we're at our record right now and playing as hard and as physical and every week as we are is because guys like that.
NFL prospects for Devontae Davis. I know the injury obviously is a little bit of a setback in terms of numbers, but he's still got a good chance of getting to the next level.
Absolutely. He'll be drafted where we'll see. He's got enough film from this year by the end of the year to not that have be an issue for him. The injury is not anything that's permanent, and so he's be interesting to see what happens with him this spring.
Let's hope he has some big numbers here in these final two games.
This guy, he'll be successful at whatever he does, whether it's football or after football.
No, very true.
I'm going to hire him, but I think he's too smart to be a coach.
Hey, up next, we're going to talk a little Runner Rebels basketball. The season has started. The opening game shows some key things that fans can expect to see throughout. We're going to take a close look and hear from Coach Rice and the players in just 2 minutes as the Red Zone rolls on.
You're watching the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by Born and Raised, the official home of the Rebels on the Road, and by Cox Communications.
We are taping Reb Zone on Sunday afternoon, so our Run and Rebel focus is on Friday night and the season opener against Morehead State. And this had UNLV fans holding their breath to the very end.
Plenty of opening night buzz and excitement as the Runnin' Rebels tipped off the 2014-15 season against Morehead State. Freshman Rashad Vaughn got his collegiate career off to a good start as he started getting shots inside and out. Christian Wood threw down a dunk 4 minutes into the game that got the crowd to their feet. And Good Luck Okonovo established himself as an inside presence with several blocks. In the first half, point guard Cody Doolin had to go to the bench after his second foul, and it became clear how much his presence on the floor means. UNLV saw a lead turn into a 5-point deficit as Morehead State made a run. The Rebs were down 7 twice in the first half, but this late bucket by Jalon Kendrick cut the deficit to 5 as the teams went into halftime. In the first 20 minutes, UNLV shot 37%, including 1 of 10 from 3-point range. Morehead opened the second half on an 8-2 run to open up an 11-point lead, and then the Rebels started chipping away. Back-to-back threes by Patrick McCaw tied the game at 47 at the midway point, and UNLV took a 4-point lead as part of an 18-3 run with the Rebels' 2-3 zone keying the comeback. Woods' dunk with 3 minutes to go gave UNLV a 5-point lead. Morehead wouldn't go away, though, and tied it at 57 with 90 seconds left. Just over a minute to go, Vaughn drains the triple for the lead. Final play, UNLV up 1. Morehead's play blown up by Doolin, who comes up big. The Runnin' Rebels notch their first win of the season as they prevail 60-59.
Watching a young basketball team grow up in a hurry. We came back from 11 down. Nothing went right for us offensively for a lot of the first half of the game, but we just kept battling back.
Once I start going to the basket, I think that's when I start getting my confidence because they really wasn't stopping it. So I was just getting to the free throw line, and my mid-range was falling. I know one of my threes was going to fall.
Anytime you score 60 points and win a basketball game, those are the kind of games that you have to grind out. And I think if you can win those games, you can potentially be a pretty good team if we can play that kind of defense. And so I thought it was just a great way for all of us to start off. And it was a lot of fun, like you said. It was rocking in there. So I had a great time.
We are back to wrap up the Reb Zone right after this. Stay with us.
You're watching the Fox 5 Reb Zone Sports Show, presented by Born and Raised, the official home of the Rebels on the Road, and by Cox Communications.
Coach, good luck in Hawaii. Aloha.
Aloha. Let's go get them.
Let's have some fun on the islands. Next week, John Castagnino will be here in studio with Coach Hauck to break down the Hawaii game and look ahead to the battle for the cannon. I'm going to be in New York with the Run of Rebels. We'll sit down with Dave Rice at the Barclays Center in Brooklyn. So we hope you can join us for a coast-to-coast Reb Zone and beyond as we go from New York City all the way over to Hawaii and everything in between. Here's the Rebel Football Plays of the Week. Thanks for joining us in the Reb Zone. Good night.
One, two, three, back. I'm a long-lost wandering soul trying to find where I belong. And I'm looking for a place where it feels all right to be wrong. Just a loudmouth, hard-headed, fool-hearted, stubborn old son of a gun. Chip off the old block, put a chip on my shoulder, that weighs a ton. All I know for sure is that nothing is forever. And all that matters is how we get along together. It's harder every day that I get older. Hope I figure out why I'm here before it's over. Cause we're here today, hey, and gone tomorrow. We're here today, hey, and gone tomorrow. Please.
Fox 5's Reb Zone Sports Show was presented by Born and Raised, the official home of the Rebels on the Road, and by Cox Communications.